see shattered, you see whole. I see broken, but you see beautiful, and you're helping me to believe. Restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty
Hey there, church. Welcome to Elkhorn Hills, where we are sharing the love for Jesus Christ by serving others. I'm Pastor Daniel Kipp, and I'm so glad that you have chosen to be part of our online worshiping community. Remember that no matter where we are or how we choose to worship with Elkhorn Hills, there are five ways that every day we can share the love for Jesus Christ by serving others. Every day we can help someone, we can include someone, we can listen to the Holy Spirit. We can learn the life of Christ in every day. We get to live as if we are sent because we are on a mission from God. And so in the spirit of being Elkhorn Hills, of recognizing that we have more than enough through the power of God to share with others. We have an abundance. Recognizing that others have an abundance that God has given them, that we can include them into our lives by being vulnerable and open about our needs. Recognizing that we can receive joy from praying and listening to the Holy Spirit and learning the life of Jesus, studying scripture and studying the way that God has revealed God's self to us throughout all of church history. And then as we are led into relationship, both with God and with one another, as we are walking into this world as sent people, in all those ways, we get to share the love for Jesus Christ by serving others. I hope that you are in your community allowing God's light to shine through you, that you are being transfigured and meeting people where they are. We are talking about being neighbors. What does it mean to be a good neighbor? Well, to me, being a good neighbor means that we recognize that God wants us to lean into that favor that God has for us. That is called joy. Joy is when we recognize that God loves us and there's nothing we can do about it. And if we want to, we can respond to that joy and live in a transformed world as we live transformed lives. And then as we have that joy, we recognize that there is an abundance, that God is the God of abundance. And in a world of scarcity, that we recognize that God is doing a good work. And so we say, all right, God, I'm going to lean into the abundance that you are bringing up within me, and I'm going to recognize the abundance that you have placed in others. And ultimately, that joy and that abundance leads us to loving God and loving our neighbor. Right now, my heart is heavy, as it often is as I think about the world and the hurt that exists. We live in a world of scarcity, and in a world of scarcity, there are many ways that people reach out in harmful and destructive ways to try to overcome this sense of scarcity. And in that, oftentimes people become hurt, people become objects. And so we are constantly thinking, God, how can you do this work of humanizing those around us, of reminding us of the divine worth of the people around us, that we might be able to look at them and go, wow, you're awesome because you are created in the image of God. And each day, God is doing the work of transforming you. And so oftentimes we think of that within the scope of the difficult people that are in our life and in our world. And I would just remind us that for every difficult person that I have in my life, I am a difficult person for someone else. And so in those senses, that's part of what allows me to be able to extend grace to others and to remember that I was first loved by God. And because I'm loved by God, then I can love God and love others. And we know that there is evil and injustice and oppression in this world. Right now, I want us to join together in a moment of prayer for the people of Ukraine and for the people of Russia. We see on the news that there are people in Russia who are marching through their streets chanting, no war, no war, even as there are people in Ukraine trying to figure out how to just make it to tomorrow. And so we don't know all the information, but we serve the God who is above all. And so we pray, and I would invite you right now to pray with me. God, we breathe in and we breathe out, recognizing that as we look out into the sky, that we are looking out at the reflection of the same earth that covers areas like Ukraine and Russia and other areas of conflict across our globe. We know that even though right now the newest and loudest conflict that we are experiencing is this conflict, as it seems that Russia is invading Ukraine, God, we recognize that there is hurt and brokenness in this world. God, for those who are scared, who are injured, who don't know where to turn, we ask that you would be present with them in a special way. God, for our world leaders, we pray that you would fall heavy upon their hearts, and that no matter what the conflict, that you would bring your awareness, your peace, your wholeness. Come, Lord Jesus, remind us that the kingdom has come near. Allow us to receive you into our hearts and into our lives. It's in your name that we pray, and the people say, Amen. So, church, how are we neighbors? This is our last Sunday of looking at what it means to be a neighbor as we finish up Luke chapter 10. And we are reading the story of Mary and Martha. And we've heard this story in many different ways. And my hope is that there's something a little bit different about what we have today. And my prayer is that as we move into studying this passage, that God would guard what is spoken and what is heard, that we might hear God's voice and be transformed this day. Amen? Let's be transformed, people. So, because last week we read the Transfiguration story, I'll remind you that we have, just in the order of Luke, come off the heels of the story of the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan, where Jesus is asked, who is my neighbor? And Jesus says, your neighbor is the person who God has equipped you to go and to serve and to love and to sacrifice for. We're given this cool little juxtaposition. I actually, 2 weeks ago, got to talk to one of our new members of the church, Brad Barrows, who is a retired pastor, and we were talking about this passage, and he said, well, did you notice that both the Levite and the priest, that they are journeying from Jerusalem to Jericho? And so, church, I think that's an important thing for us to recognize. Here we have two people who have probably been practicing holiness and cleansing in the temple, and they are journeying to go somewhere else to minister. And if they want to remain clean in the temple sense, if they care for this individual, they'd have to turn back and go back to Jerusalem before going on to Jericho. Now, it's interesting that we find that if we kind of piece things together, that it would seem that Jesus is on this same road from Jericho to Jerusalem. But instead of journeying away from Jericho, or away from Jerusalem, he is journeying towards Jerusalem. And here we see that what is expected, that those, so a priest would be the most holy person you could think of. They don't help. The next holiest person you could think of would be a Levite. They don't help. The progression here would be that maybe a Jewish lay person, or maybe even a local rabbi would be the one who comes by and shows compassion. The listeners would have been expecting that the third person would be the compassionate one. And it is so shocking that it is a heretic. It is someone who does not match up racially or ethnically or theologically, who helps this person in need. And so we see that Jesus says, I want you to not act as you are expected to act. I want you to move in the unexpected. And in the sense of the unexpected, we move into the story of Mary and Martha. Now, it's important that we recognize that the point of the Good Samaritan story is not that we serve our neighbors. It is that we are faithful in following the leading of God, even when it calls us to do something that is unexpected, and especially when it calls us to do something that is unexpected. So let us turn to the scripture. This is Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 38 and going through verse 42. So super long passage. Let's hit it. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now, as we go through this passage, especially as we get to verse 42, I have some issues with the way that a lot of our Bibles have chosen to translate this passage. And so we'll talk about that here in a moment. But before we get there, let's go ahead and look at the beginning here. First, there are some who would make this a dichotomy. They would say, don't be a Martha, be a Mary. Or there are those who would say, there are two paths here. There's the Martha path of serving, and there's the Mary path of learning, and that you need to know which path you're on and for how long you should stay on that path. There's been so many ways that people have looked at this, and I don't think that there is a dichotomy here at all. I think that there is a story of a disciple named Martha who is worried about her relationship with God, and who maybe leans a little bit upon her own understanding instead of on trusting God. In church, as I think about it in terms of that, and I think about it in terms of a disciple seeking to follow God, and a disciple who might put too much trust in what they understand or in the way that they've learned to follow God, I find not just an image of Martha, but I find a picture of myself. There are so many times when I make following God about what I know or what I'm used to doing, and I can do a really good job of being that kind of a follower of Jesus. In fact, sometimes following Jesus is about being a good Christian to me, and let's just level things right now. Sometimes being a good Christian, being a good Methodist, being a good whatever, is not actually being faithful in following Jesus. Because the primary characteristic of a follower of Jesus is that they follow Jesus. And so we look and we say, all right, so how is God inviting us to follow God, to be a follower of Jesus? That's a really great question. So let's start by establishing who Martha is. I'm going to be real straightforward with you. I believe that Martha is a pastor. The reason for that is because we know that the book of Luke was written after the ascension of Jesus. It's written in the time of the church being established. We're not exactly sure when it's written, but we know that it's written probably a few decades after Jesus ascended into heaven, so after the resurrection. So we have the young church, and they need to know the story of Jesus. And so when people are reading the book of Luke, they, as the church, are given some code words that they're supposed to pay attention to. And I think that is helpful for us to pay attention to them too. Anytime that the word oikos comes up in Scripture, that's the word for house. And especially here in Luke, we should read house and church as being synonymous. And so usually the word for in the New Testament, especially in the letters, like Romans and Colossians and 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, all of those, usually we have ekklesia is church. But here in the Gospels, it's usually oikos or house. And so when we find out about Jesus going to someone's house or Jesus being at a house, this is really talking about church. We should be paying attention. We should be leaning in that way, that this is probably talking about church. And so we have Jesus who comes to Martha's oikos, Martha's house, Martha's church. Think about that. And so Martha offers hospitality to Jesus. And we know that here in a few short weeks, about 7-8 weeks, we're going to be having Good Friday. And we're going to have Maundy Thursday. And when we celebrate Maundy Thursday, we're going to read that story from John chapter 13 where Jesus washes the disciples' feet. And Jesus reminds them that he came to serve and not to be served. And so here, Martha is learning that lesson first, which I think is really cool. I think it's really cool that Martha gets to learn that lesson first. And Martha is caring for Jesus. And it says in verse 39, that Martha has a sister named Mary. And those of you who have a younger sister already know that Mary is the younger sister. But in case you didn't know that Mary was the younger sister, we believe that Mary is the younger sister in this story because of the roles that they've taken. Martha would have been expected as the leader of this house to be the one to offer hospitality to Jesus. And Mary, as the younger sister, would have been expected to help Martha in doing that. But Mary does the unexpected, and she does it because she's invited by Jesus. Jesus is the first person to break the rules here, and they're the rules of being social within that context, within that culture. And it says that she has a sister named Mary, and Mary sat at Jesus' feet listening to what he said. Now, sitting at Jesus' feet is the posture of a disciple. So is serving. I want to be clear here. Mary and Martha both are operating as disciples of Jesus. Mary is adopting the posture of learning. Martha adopting the posture of serving. Now here's the interesting thing, and I think this is the thing that Martha misses, is that usually when we look at the way that Jesus calls disciples to serve, it's not to serve Jesus. It is to be Jesus in serving others. And so we see in verse 40, Martha gets distracted. And if you don't have compassion for Martha, I want you to get some compassion for Martha. Here in verse 40, when it says that Martha gets distracted, this is compound word, and it means to draw a sword out and all around. So it's this feeling of being surrounded and having people pull out swords on you. So if you want to know how stressed out, how anxious, how overwhelmed Martha is feeling, it feels like Martha is surrounded and that there are people who are pulling out swords around her. This is the feeling that Martha has. I think we can resonate with that. We can resonate with the feeling of being so overwhelmed that it feels like there are people who want to attack us on every side. And so Martha does what many people do, what I often do. Instead of trying to seek peace in her life, seek wholeness in her life, instead of doing that, she looks to redirect that feeling upon someone else, to blame someone else for the way that she feels. And so she comes to Jesus and she says, Jesus, don't you care? And the word for care is, aren't you anxious? Don't you even think about, don't you notice? Aren't you anxious that my sister left me alone to do all the work by myself? Tell her to do what's expected of her. is basically what she's saying. Tell her to help me. Tell her to fit into social norms. Tell her to operate in the polite way of culture. This is like, I read a message the other day online where someone said, my husband sneezed and he sent me this picture. It was a screenshot. And it said, is it rude not to say bless you after someone sneezes? And clearly we get this, we're able to read into the story and realize she did not say to him, bless you, after he sneezed. And so he shot her a screenshot saying, you didn't do what you were supposed to do. Well, that husband, like me, like Martha, is going, there are polite things to do. There are expectations of people, and you're not following it. And Jesus does this amazing thing where Jesus, instead of getting defensive, Jesus has more compassion for Martha. Jesus does this amazing thing that God always does, and Jesus extends grace and uses this as an opportunity to teach one of his disciples how to better love God and how better to love their neighbor. And he starts off, we know it's compassionate because he says, Martha, Martha. Getting her full attention and using full feeling, saying, Martha, Martha. Isn't it wonderful to know that God knows us by name? And that in our moments where we feel overwhelmed and like we can't handle what life is giving us, that God says our name. God says it again just so that we're paying attention. And he says, you are worried, you are anxious, and you are upset. This word for upset means to be tumultuous in your soul. So think of a storm in their spirit. You are anxious and you are upset about many things. But, now the NIV, this is, I told you, verse 42. Verse 42 says, only one thing is needed. And then my version here has a little A, right? Like, so you drop down to the subscript, and in the subscript it says, some manuscripts say, but few things are needed, or only one thing is needed. The oldest manuscripts we have here say a few things are needed. A few things are needed. Now, here's the cool thing. This is twofold. First, Jesus doesn't forget about what was important to Martha. Martha was worried about the meal. Martha was worried about being a good hostess. And so and Mary is worried about treating Jesus like the guest he deserves to be treated as. Do you see how all of this is really good? And Jesus doesn't forget that. In fact, Jesus says, I know that you want to give me the lavish dinner that you think I deserve and that you think I expect. But that's not what I expect. I just expect a few things. Remember, Jesus is the Jesus who sent out the 12 and sent out the 70 and said, eat whatever is prepared for you. Don't take anything with you. And just allow God to care for you by receiving whatever is offered. Jesus is saying, you don't have to do a whole bunch of fancy stuff for me. Just give me a few things. Feed my body. My body is important, but my body is not everything. Give me enough to sustain me. A few things are needed. On the other side, we can take this to that spiritual side of saying, all right, we can make following Jesus about a whole bunch of different things. We can make being a faithful follower of God about a whole bunch of different things. In fact, it is amazing how many of us disagree on many, many things within the church, and yet we're able to still follow Jesus together. And this is one of those things where I don't want to get deep into it, but it astounds me the things that we're willing to separate in relationship over when there are so many things that we disagree about. How is it that we choose what the right things to go separate ways about is? Like, that is a fascinating conversation for us to have at some point. But Jesus says a few things are needed. and Mary has chosen one. Now, we don't get to hear the conversation with Mary. We don't get to hear the part maybe where Jesus says, "Hey, Mary, I love that you have chosen the one thing to sit at my feet, to be my disciple, to love on me and to worship me. I love that. But a few things are required, and not just one thing." We don't know if that's the conversation. I don't know. You don't know. But we know that here Jesus is saying Mary has chosen one thing, and that the one thing that she has chosen, that this is a good thing that she has chosen, and she's received a blessing for it. That choosing to pause and to be in the presence of God is a good thing. It's a good portion. In fact, that's the word that's used here. If we translate it, is chosen the good portion. Like, this is the thing, right? Like, so Mary is trying to provide the good portion, the good meal for Jesus. And Jesus says, the good portion is what I have to offer. And this makes me think of the woman at the well who comes to the well in the middle of the day and is going to draw up water. And Jesus is there. And Jesus says, "Will you draw me some water to drink?" And she's like, "Why would you ask me? I'm a Samaritan. You're a Jew. Like, why would we have this?" And Jesus says to her, "If you knew who I was, you would have asked me. And I would have given you a drink from the well that never runs dry." And she says, "Please, sir, give me of this drink." And Jesus says, I am that well. And so we see that here Mary chooses the good portion, chooses Jesus. Now Martha shouldn't feel bad, because we read in John chapter 12 that again, this is further on. This isn't right here, we don't think. It could be. Jesus is in Bethany, and Mary and Martha are there, and it says that Martha is serving, and in that sense, it doesn't paint Martha in a bad sense or anything like that. We get this idea, though, then, that Mary takes and anoints Jesus's feet with oil, with oil that's expensive, that costs a year's wages to buy. And that she's wiping and cleaning Jesus' feet with her own hair. And one of the disciples says to her, "What are you doing?" And says to Jesus, "Let's rebuke her. She just is wasteful." That aroma could have been sold, and it could have been used to feed those who are hungry. And Jesus says, "No, she has done a good thing here." Now, again, we see Mary and Martha show up in John chapter 11. And here is where we get that great verse, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," right? I am the resurrection and the life. And it's the resurrection of Lazarus. And we're told that when Jesus does come to Lazarus, he'd been told that Lazarus was sick. He waited. Lazarus dies. Jesus goes to be with Mary and Martha in Bethany. And as he arrives, he gets there. And Martha comes to him and says, you're late, Jesus. If you would have come earlier, you could have saved him." Actually, you know, let's go ahead and read that real quick. And John chapter 11, verse 17. "On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home." So first, now we should get the same image as the prodigal son when the father comes running to the son, to embrace the son. Like, this is who Martha is. Like, Martha is, she is the leader of this church. Martha is his faithful disciple. And so Martha comes out to meet Jesus and says, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." And Jesus said, "Your brother will rise again." And she says, "Yes, I know he will rise again at the resurrection." You know, it's the same hope that you and I have. And she is such a person of faith and hope. And she says, "Yes, I know, but I'm still sad right now." And after she said this, She went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and he is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in the spirit and troubled. Here is that anxiety that Martha was looking for when Jesus was coming and she was serving and Mary was worshiping Jesus. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see the Lord," "come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there for 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God?" And so they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here with them before that you have sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth across his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave cloths and let him go." And so we have this beautiful, beautiful story of Martha saying, "You know, I believe that you had something that you could do about this, Jesus. I know that even now that God's moving, even though things didn't go the way that I wanted them to go." And Jesus says, "Your brother will rise." And Martha's like, "Yeah, I totally get it. I believe it. At the end of all things, he will rise." And Jesus says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." And she says, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world." Like, this is who Martha is. Martha is the one who is faithful, who loves Jesus, but who also gets caught up in the work of being a good follower, of wanting to be the best follower of Jesus that she possibly can be. And when she does that, she misses out on being a good neighbor. And church, I'm here to tell you that being a good neighbor is awkward. It's awkward because being a good neighbor means that we see our neighbor. We see Jesus present in them. And it's usually outside of what is expected of us. Martha missed the moment to really be with Jesus because she was so busy focusing on all the things that it took to love Jesus that she missed Jesus. And there are times when we can get caught up in the same, that we're so focused on doing the things that are required for us to love God that we miss out on God with us. There are so many times that we can be so focused on all the things that is required to love our neighbor that we miss out on our neighbor with us. Loving our neighbor is awkward because it means seeing God and seeing our neighbor right there alongside us and sometimes acting outside of what is expected of us. And that's awkward because it's not easy. It's not, you know, we can't get into a rut or into a rhythm. We have to be willing to be pulled outside of that. One of my favorite phrases within ministry in the church is the ox in the ditch. We have so many different moments where we have good protocols and systems and methods for doing things. But we see over and over again that Jesus says there are times when we operate outside of that because that's where the Spirit moves. So when we go on mission trips, Jenny likes to laugh at me because she'll ask me a question about how we should do something. I'll go, well, is the ox in the ditch? And if the ox is in the ditch, then we follow Jesus in taking care of whoever that ox might be. So this week, this is what I want you to do. I want you to think about all the things that you do to love God and love neighbor. And maybe you need to put a name on your neighbor. So think about your neighbor who is your child, or your neighbor who is your coworker, or your neighbor who is the person who lives next to you. Think about who your neighbor is. Think of specific neighbors. And I want you to think about the ways that you're loving your neighbors. Is the way that you're trying to love your neighbor getting in the way of you loving your neighbor? Think about the ways that you're trying to worship God and love God. Is your practice of loving God getting in the way of loving God? I pray that it isn't. And if it is, it's okay. I want you to hear God say your name, just like he said, Martha, Martha, you are worried about many things, but only a few things are required. And sometimes we need to be like Mary and just focus on one thing. So if you're a list person, write it down. If you're not a list person, that's okay. You don't have to write it down. But I want you to think, is the way that I'm trying to love God and love my neighbor, is that becoming more important than actually spending time with God and neighbor? Because we cannot be moved by the Spirit if we're already occupied with the busyness of life. And here's the other piece of that. We know that we're probably being occupied by the things of life, that we're being more focused on the ways that we love God or the ways that we love our neighbor, that we know when those moments happen, because it feels like how Martha felt, like we're surrounded and people are pulling out swords, that we are overwhelmed and we are anxious. So church, if you are overwhelmed and anxious, I invite you to simplify things. And in true Methodist fashion, I'll just remind you that we have three simple rules. Love God. Do all the good you can by all the means you can in all the places you can for as long as ever you can. Do no harm. Resist evil and injustice and oppression. And attend to the ordinances of God. Do the things that help you fall in love with God. And may you go forth in the love of God, in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and in the communion of the Holy Spirit. May you take peace with you in all the spaces that you abide. Amen.